rise from the dead. She lay, skin down in the moist dirt. The canebrake rustling in the whispers of leaves, and the loud lowing of hounds, and the ramshack of hunters crackling in their branches. She mutters, lifting her head a nod toward freedom. I shall not be moved. She gathers her babies, tears slick as oil on black faces, their young eyes canvassing the mornings of madness. Mama, is Master going to sell you from us tomorrow? Yes, unless you start walking more and talking less. Yes, unless the keeper of our lives releases me from all commandments, yes. And your young lives, never mind to live, will be executed on the killing floors of innocence, unless you match my heart and words and say with me, I shall not be moved. In Virginia tobacco fields, leaning into the curve of Steinway pianos, along Arkansas roads, in the red hills of Georgia, into the palm of her chained hands, she cried against calamity. You have tried to destroy me, and though I perish daily, I shall not be moved. Her universe, often summarized into one black body, falling finally from the tree to her feet, made her cry each time in a new voice. All my past hastens to defeat, and strangers claim the glory of my love. Iniquity has bound me to this bed, yet I must not be moved. Her universe. She heard the names, swirling ribbons in the past of history. Nigger, nigger bitch, mammy, whore, preacher, ape, baboon, hot tail, property, thing, it, she said. But my description cannot fit your tongue, for I have a way in this world, and I shall not be moved. The divine upon my right impels me to pull forever at the latch on freedom's gate. The Holy Spirit upon my left lead my feet without ceasing into the camp of the righteous and into the tents of the free. These mama faces, lemon yellow, plum purple, honey brown, have grimaced and twisted down the pyramids for years. She is Sheba, Sojourner, Harriet and Zora, Mary Bethune and Angela. She stands before the abortion clinic, confounded by the lack of choices, in the welfare line, reduced to the risks of handouts, on a lonely street corner, hawking her body, in the classroom, loving the children to understanding. Centered on the world stage, she sings to her loves and beloved, to her foes and detractors, however I am perceived or deceived, however my ignorance and conceits. Lay aside your fear that I will be undone, for I shall not be moved. For I shall not be moved.
Hey, Bailey, doesn't your sister look beautiful? You got prettier.
You know, it looks better than family.
Yes. I guess they do. Maya, I read in the paper the other day that you were going to work with Malcolm X in some new organization. I hope not. I really hope not. If you have to do that, go work for no money. Why don't you go work with Dr. King? He's really trying to help our people. That Malcolm X, he's a rabble-rouser. Relax, child. See, I still have the recipe you sent me from Ghana. It says, cook about a pound of rice, saute a couple or three onions in some not too much cooking oil. Add in three or four right-sized tomatoes. Make sure they're firm. After that, you cut up some ham. Nice size pieces. Not too big though, you don't want to choke. You mix that in with some fried chicken cut into nice size pieces. Add some tomato sauce. Don't forget the seasonings. You gotta add a little adobo and a pinch of cayenne pepper just to give it that kick. Then you mix that into tomato sauce and let that simmer. After a while, you mix in that rice you started earlier. Wow, I think I'm starting to smell that now.
That sounds good. But you know, Hawaiian tourists, they have some interesting dinner rules. They order fried chicken, biscuits, and short ribs and cornbread.
Well, we're cooking out good old stew. So let's go wait until it's done. Come on, guys.
Here, at this final hour, in this quiet place, we have come to bid farewell to one of Harlem's brightest hopes, extinguished now and gone from us forever. For Harlem is where he worked and where he struggled and fought, his home of homes, where his heart was and where his people are. And it is most fitting that we meet once again in Harlem, to share these last moments with him, for Harlem has ever been so gracious to those who have loved her and have fought her and have defended her honor even to the dead. It is not in the memory of man that this beleaguered, unfortunate, but nonetheless proud community has found a braver, more gallant young champion than this Afro-American who lies before us, unconquered still. I say the word again, as he would want me to, Afro-American, Afro-American Malcolm, who was a master, was most meticulous in his use of words. Nobody knew better than he the power that words have on the minds of men. Malcolm had stopped being a Negro years ago. It was too small, too puny, too weak a word for him. Malcolm was bigger than that. Malcolm had become an Afro-American. He wanted so desperately that we, all of his people, would become Afro-Americans too. There are those who will consider it their duty as friends of the Negro people to tell us to evolve him, to flee even from the presence of his memory, to save ourselves by writing him out of the history of our turbulent times. Many will ask, what Harlem finds to honor in a man in the stormy, controversial, and bold young captain? And we will smile. Many will say, turn away from this man, for he is not a man, but a demon, a monster, a subverter, and an enemy of the black man. And we will smile. They will say that he is of hate, a fanatic, a racist, who can only bring evil to the cause for which you struggle. And we will answer and say to them, did you ever talk to Brother Malcolm? Did you ever touch him or have him smile at you? Did you ever really listen to him? Did he ever do a mean thing? Was he ever himself associated with violence or any public disturbance? For if you did, you would then know him. And if you knew him, you would then know why we must honor him. Malcolm was our manhood, our living black manhood. This was his meaning to his people. And in honoring him, we honor the best in ourselves. Last year, from Africa, he wrote these words to a friend. My journey, he says, is almost ended, and I have a much broader scope than when I started out, which I believe will add new life and dimension to our struggle for freedom and honor and dignity in the States. I am writing these things so that you will know for a fact the tremendous sympathy and support we have among the African states for our human rights struggle. The main thing is that we keep a united front wherein our most valuable time and energy will not be wasted fighting each other. However, we may have differed with him or with each other about him and his values as a man. Let his going from us serve only to bring us together now. Consigning these mortal remains to the earth, the common mother of all, secure in the knowledge that what we place in the ground is no longer a man, but a seed, which after the winter of our discontent will come forth again to meet us. And we will know him then for what and was and is a prince, our own black shining prince, who didn't hesitate to die because he loved us so.
On February 21st, 1965, the Organization for African American Unity rented the Audubon Ballroom for a fundraiser. Malcolm was the speaker. Had I stayed in New York after I came back from Ghana, would I have heard Malcolm's final words? Would I have been sitting with his daughters and wife? Would I have heard the bullets puncture the air? Would I have seen the killers' faces? in my mind for eternity?
As for me and my romantic other half, he could not fit into my world, nor I into his. He was this powerful African, West African, who swept me off my feet. I had been in love many times. Honey child, let me tell you. This one, I had promised him and gave my word, and I gave my body, but I would not give him my soul. You see, this one here, he was used to being obeyed, and he insisted on having all of me. The pleasure, oh, I couldn't say no. Oh, after a month of giving up my authority and giving up my life, I realized what a big, big mistake I had made. Check this out. If I wanted chicken,
I wanted love.
And I quickly agreed. If I wanted rice,
I wanted yolks.
And I quickly agreed. You see, he said that I agreed with everything that he wanted. And I agreed. If I wanted to visit with my friends,
I wanted to be alone, but not without you.
And I agreed. If I wanted to sit up and read,
I wanted to go to bed.
And he added,
but I not without you.